The fish are so meaty.
Mm-hmm. Fishermen's gear is getting saturated with black sea bass. They're just everywhere. There's not demand for it because people don't know about it.
Right.
Let's try to take an opportunity with these fish.
Might even be the fish of the future.
Hi, my name is Douglas Williams. I'm the chef and owner of Meter Restaurants. It's no secret that our planet is changing, and with it, what we eat. There is no waiting. We can taste it, we can sense it, we can smell it, we can talk about it, and we can listen to each other about it. And that starts in the kitchen.
So today we're making black sea bass almondine.
Sounds delicious.
I'm in the kitchen today with the Museum of Science to ask, what's on tomorrow's menu?
Helen Cheng is a climate scientist and self-described foodie from Northeastern University. Helen joins me in the kitchen today to talk about the black sea bass and why it could end up on tomorrow's menu.
All right, let's get cooking.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna turn this on high. A little bit of oil.
Okay.
I don't wanna just do this in oil. I wanna do this in butter as well, so it gets brown. It's frying it, it's doing all these things, and then we use that said butter for the sauce. I think we all kind of put fish in this kind of one big, large category, but I would love to hear kind of your special interest in black bass.
Yeah, black sea bass is a really beautiful fish. They're local to the Northeast, to New England especially. Black sea bass are technically groupers. They're part of the grouper family. They're sort of what they're called benthic feeders, and so they just feed things that are on the bottom of the seafloor. Mm-hmm. You can actually find them in Boston Harbor.
No way.
Black sea bass generally love eating crustaceans. That's one of the big questions that we're trying to answer, is whether black sea bass could eat lobster.
Or affect that population.
Exactly.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
The Gulf of Maine is warming faster than 99% of the world's oceans, mm-hmm. and it's a startling statistic. And so these warming conditions are allowing black sea bass to move and expand their range into this region.
Right.
And as optimal conditions become more favorable for them, black sea bass are slowly expanding their range into the Gulf of Maine.
So it's less of a robber invading your home and more like a lot of family moving in your home. And now you have to like—
And now, figure out how
it's gonna go inside.
Yeah,
wow,
exactly.
Okay, that's very, very interesting.
Yeah, I've heard stories and accounts that fishermen's gear are being saturated with black sea bass. Really, it has to be this exchange of local ecological knowledge to be able to accommodate for both the species and the fishers themselves.
Absolutely.
This smells delicious.
I hope so. I was trying to interrupt you. It's crispy, it's brown butter, it's all on there. But now we take this beautiful brown butter, and now we're gonna essentially make our sauce.
Okay.
We're actually gonna add some garlic, okay? And we're just gonna let that just kind of roast, and you can see what that does.
Oh, wow.
We have one of the crown jewels, chopped lemon. It has the rind, it has the seeds, it has the juice, it has the zest, everything in it. I'm just gonna add that into here.
My mom loves making whole black sea bass, and she'll actually steam it whole. In Asian cultures, fish is actually considered a symbol of luck and abundance. And so that's why we tend to eat fish during the Lunar New Year or during holidays, family gatherings.
Absolutely. As far as seeing it on menus, I think the most times that I see it is usually on Japanese menus, on sushi, but I don't see it that much in regular restaurant menus, and I think that's kind of a shame.
And I do think it's because people are maybe not aware that black sea bass is available, it's a great option, maybe being open to trying something new versus ordering the same dish over and over again.
Sure, but this is it. So just a simple dish that gives you this texture. It's easy, it's simple, it's one pan.
Amazing.
Thank you.
Smells great.
Let's give a little, taste. Okay.
That's really good. Mm-hmm. Taste the brightness.
The fish is so meaty.
Mm-hmm.
Way meatier than I anticipated. It actually has this like density.
Right, yeah. It's nice and flaky and it's like slightly firm, but really easy to eat too. Mm-hmm. And that's why I love like eating black sea bass. It absorbs the flavor of what you're putting into, and it's nice and delicate.
Why would the black sea bass becoming more commercially available be a good thing?
Being able to see it on our menus and being able to market it in a way that you're eating something that's delicious, available, local, and good. How do we take opportunity of these fish that are starting to come into our waters? Scientists have been looking into how many are there, where are they located, and all this data is going to influence how much we catch each year,
right?
We also want a balanced ecosystem, right? We don't want one species to dominate over another. Yeah. I think it's really valuable to have like this dialogue between our fishers, the scientist, the consumer, mm-hmm. what they're seeing mm-hmm. too. And if mm-hmm. we can teach people about what's happening in our waters, because what happens in our waters influence what Absolutely. We do on land, right? Absolutely. We as consumers drive the market. And if right. we know that these fish are delicious and they're mm-hmm. available, mm-hmm. and I think that's where I think the gap is, that there's not demand for it because people don't know about it.
Right. I surely think this will be on tomorrow's menu. This is a supremely textural delight that I think I can work with. Now we just gotta go fishing for it.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'll take you fishing.
Maybe that'll be the next promo.
Yeah.
This is great.